This article today begins with a reference to Tamil Nadu government recently deciding not to use the word center in its official communications and to use the word union instead to describe the government of India. Now, Tamil Nadu, as you know, whether it is anti-Hindi agitation or non-Congress governments or coalition, opposing the on idea of the government of India's policy on the Tamils in Sri Lanka, wherever, it has shown the way to the whole country about how to deal with the government of India, especially in matters where there is discord between the center and the states. Now, what we must understand is that basically the word center does not exist in the constitution, in any of the parts or any of the articles. It is only the word union that is used. And originally, the constitution makers wanted to be sure that India is not to be a federation in the sense that United States is, or a unitary form of government in the sense that United Kingdom is, but it wanted that it should be a different amalgam of the two. What they wanted was that the states were already autonomous, as you know. All the princely states were consolidated, and the British, Madras, Bombay presidencies, they were all brought together and made into a country. So it was actually a union of independent entities, like in the state of America, but not quite, because once they joined, a new thing, a creature came in called the union government. So both have separate entities. So for the sake of administration, though the country is divided into units of states and all that, it is basically one unit. I'm saying this because, peculiarly enough, as you know, Parliament has the power to create new states, to alter the boundaries of existing states, to combine two states, to cut away a portion of a state, etc., which shows that Parliament's supremacy cannot be questioned in this dispensation. And we'll come to that other part in a minute. The original intention was to put in place a central government with very limited powers, because they didn't want to tinker with the autonomy of the princely states or offend their sentiments. But then partition came, and then the violence that followed in its wake. Therefore, they got a little worried about the possibility of secession by the original states in the future. So they opted for a stronger center. But the Constituent Assembly was very clear that the union was not an agreement, like in the state of United States, where all the states agreed to form a, no. Here it was sort of brought in by the Constitution. So nobody is free to withdraw from this arrangement. So it is not an agreement, sort of agreement in that sense. In fact, Dr. Ambedkar said that India shall be a union of states and that the federation is indestructible. So nothing can change its quality. So in fact, there's a lot of opposition to Ambedkar at that time, particularly from a member called Maulana Hasrat Mohani, who went to the extent of comparing Ambedkar with Kaiser William and Hitler in Germany, who are not really very happy comparisons. Then Ambedkar also said India was not a league of states or a loose relationship, nor the state and agencies of the union. So they were, you see, it's not as if the states are merely administrative units, as I said in the beginning, that was an exaggeration. It's each has its own authority and power in its own, field and area, as they defined in the constitution. So in fact, the author has not mentioned it, but I want to tell you that in the Constitution of India, although it's not specifically explicitly mentioned, the concept of two states emerges. There is a state within quotation marks at the national level, which is the central government, union government, parliament, and the Supreme Court. These three together form a state, with this president being the head of the state. In the states, the governor is the head of the state comprising the legislatures, the state government, and the High Court of the state. So there are two states actually created by the constitution, although it does not explicitly say so. So, but you can see various things, like for instance, the Supreme Court is not superior court to administratively to the high courts. It cannot, for instance, inspect the work of the high courts and all that, but it has appellate jurisdiction. But the high courts can inspect the district courts and subordinate courts and all that. So therefore, there is an element of subordination below the state level. So it is a very carefully worked out arrangement. As you know, parliament has its own union list. States have their own state list for legislation under the constitution. And there is a concurrent list where both can legislate. But with the caveat that where parliamentary law and the state law, the legislature law contradict each other, conflict arises, then the parliament law, sort of prevails. Therefore, there's a clear sense coming out that the state at the national level is really an entity more powerful than the state at the state level. So, the High Court, then, in fact, the fact that the union government can impose an emergency like it did in 1976, for instance, that itself shows the supremacy of the state at the national level. So in the ultimate analysis, it's a compromise between two conflicting considerations, such as the autonomy originally enjoyed by the princely states on the one hand, and the need for a strong center in view of the need to preserve the integrity and unity of the country on the other hand. So, of course, it's a different matter that over time, in financial matters, the center has cornered all the authority and power, and as has come to be known as the center, because that is the word used in the so-called, you must have heard of the General Clauses Act. That is where the word center was first used. In fact, that has no constitutional validity at all. So, as we observed in the earlier class, this situation can be set right by giving greater autonomy to the states to levy taxes and collect them, etc., etc., and also reduce the area in which center can function, and also not make it any more possible for the center to collect and allocate monies. On the other hand, as we observed also in the earlier class, the Niti Aayog can have a big fund at its disposal so that disparities in the incomes and resources available to states can be corrected. So the Indian constitution, as you know, ultimately it is for these disparities alone that the finance commission has been created, but the finance commission has a sort of remit and a jurisdiction which is very rigid and limited. So the Niti Aayog can come in its place and use the resources available with the center to correct imbalances. In fact, I can do no better than to quote Mr. Ambedkar at the end. Before quoting, let me sum up what we discussed. Firstly, why do we have a federation with a unitary bias, as it is called? Essentially a federation, but with a unitary bias. Why? Because concerns about disunity, as I mentioned to you after partition, need for uniform development, as I said about Niti Aayog having funds, then protection of minorities, because that is something, it's an all India issue and each state cannot have a policy of its own. And then the interests of the original princely states. In fact, B.R. Ambedkar once described India and its states as one integral whole, its people being a single people living under a single imperium derived from a single source, that source being the Constitution of India. So it was necessary sentiment at that time when a newly independent and partitioned nation was trying to frame a coherent idea for itself. But the political and economic context has changed drastically since then. The relationship between the center and states has failed to keep pace with its evolution. That is the point. Sarkaria Commission, as you know, made some recommendations, and the issue is still being hotly debated every now and then. So that is my take on today's article, and I'll be happy to take any